message for the ladies and gentlemen around the world and all the ships at sea.
We all make choices, but in the end, our choices make us.
So choose wisely. Subscribe to It's Eric Nagel wherever shows are found, on whatever platform you choose. And as always, leave us a positive review. Would you kindly?
You want to tell me what happened here?
Dude, it's a fire. I don't know. I came by and was checking out the fire.
Well, that lady, Mona, she said that you two were in the building when the fire started.
Yeah, she's a liar, because I don't know her. So whatever she says is a lie, so...
Okay, so you're saying you weren't in the building with that woman?
No, not I. All right. She started it, all right? Because she was like, I hate my job. I'm going to burn this mother down. And I said, you better not. You better not.
She said it was an electrical fire.
It was. It was a total electrical fire. It was like the switches had sparks coming out and the sockets, and it's like the 4th of July, man.
It's Eric Nagel. And it starts now.
What up, my Nagel? What up, my Nagel? What up, my Nagel? What up, my Nagel? What up, my Nagel, talking about George R.R. Martin, not writing. Talking Marvel versus DC, who's more exciting? Talking George Lucas's legacy, high score on Centipede. Talking Gittle's new beef burrito recipe. Talking about Stephanie McMahon versus Sable. Talking about the Cybermen versus the Weeping Angels, don't blink. The dialect's more deadly than you think. Talking Summer Ale, Blueberry Pale, Craft Beer, Corbin Drake's, what up, my Nagel? Deadpool 2 features Cable. Talking Funko Pop, celebrity signed a label. Talking online gaming, bitching and complaining. Talking E-Rock, kissing the feet of Matt Groening. Warner Brothers properties, Superman's a mockery. Weird Al concerts, Kevin Smith's debauchery. Rick and Morty fun zone. The Lego build team, can I have your attention? Possible Donkey Kong kill screen. What up, my Nagel? What up, my Nagel? What up, my Nagel? What up, my Nagel?
Ladies and gentlemen of the universe, the next voice you hear.
Eric Nagel.
Hello and welcome to another edition of It's Eric Nagel. That is me. Over in the upside down is my buddy Gittles.
What up, buddy?
Follow us online with all the social medias. It's Eric Nagel across the board. Like us on Facebook. Subscribe to us on YouTube. By the way, thank you very much. I think we're only about 25 away from breaking the 1,000 achievement goal, whatever you want to call it, on YouTube there, because then once we hit 1,000, it allows us to do some other things that we're hoping to do with the YouTube channel. We urge you to go over there to subscribe, be a part of it. If not, you can just set it and forget it. Hit it, subscribe, walk away. You never have to deal with us again. Turn the notifications off. We don't care. We just need
you. I care.
We need the bodies. Gittles cares, but we need the bodies just to get us to 1,000. Then I'll care.
We need the bodies to... Yeah, let's isolate that one. We need the bodies to get us to 1,000. Then I'll care.
Yes. Phone number, 651-SMITHERS, 651-764-8437 if you want to be part of the program. And lots to go about and lots to do today. We have so much stuff we got to talk about. And then in the second segment of today's show, we have a guest. An epic guest, if you will.
An epic guest?
An epic guest.
An epic guest?
Our pal Epic Lloyd from Epic Rap Battles of History. We've had him on the show a few times in the past. Him and his partner, Nice Peter, they're back after a 2-year hiatus for season 6, which is going to debut. If you're listening to this, it might already be out there and available to you. But if you got this early, Saturday, 4:20, appropriate.
Yep.
Season 6 starts, and all this cool new stuff that they have coming out is going to start unrolling and being available, and we'll talk to him about all that in segment 2. But for now, it is Brian and me. And Brian, I have not seen you in a while. You went away. Where did you go? What did you do?
Just had my nerd weekend away with my friends. My buddy has a house upstate. So we just took like a little 4-day weekend. We all planned it, and we went up there and just, played a bunch of board games and, played some D&D and cooked a bunch of food and just hung out. And it was
great.
Did
you do anything manly? Did you go fish or hunt?
No, but he has a wall that's collapsing, and one of the people...
Because winter's coming?
What's up?
Because winter's coming?
Well, yeah, because it's on a cliff. We call it Cliff House because it's like literally like on the side of a cliff. But the problem is there's like a retaining wall that's crumbling. So like a piece of it broke, and we had to just go out to the store and buy a sledgehammer and like break the whole thing up and build a partial wall to fix it. So yeah, we ended up having to do shit we didn't want to do, but it was pretty good, you know, just like, you know, lots of barbecuing, lots of drinking. Lots of everything, so it was fun. I got bit by a dog. That wasn't fun, though.
A wild dog or a domesticated dog?
Some shithead dogs. This little fucking Boston Terrier. These people are walking down the street, and he comes up to me, and I'm like, just sitting there. I'm like, oh, the dog's like running up to me, like he's gotta be cool. So I put out my hand, you know, like you do. You're like, oh, hey, you want to like smell, like yeah. You know, blah blah. So he goes like, and just bites, like doesn't even give me a second, and then I'm like bleeding all over the place because he like broke skin. He bit me really hard.
Did you yell at the owners?
Yeah, well, the owners were, like, just these two girls. They must have been, like, 12. They were just, like, walking this dog, and it just came up to me. And they're like, oh, my God, you're bleeding. I was like, yeah. I was also high on mushrooms, so it wasn't, like, a good thing to have get bit by a dog. I was like, oh, geez, that wasn't fun.
He bites you, and rainbows come flying out of your hand.
I was like, oh, what's all this?
This light? Energy source comes out. Oh, no, I'm regenerating.
Yeah. So I was like, oh, yeah. What,
so
what
did
you
yell at 12-year-old girls and say, why isn't your dog on a leash? And you're not curbing your dog as you walk him?
Yeah, like the dog just runs to me. He's like, oh, usually he's friendly. And I'm like, oh, whatever. I'm like, I can't deal with this now. I got to go wash my hands. And my friends are like, yo, we're upstate. So you got to go over there and ask them if their dog has rabies. I'm like, I can't do that right now. Like, I can't go and ask them if their dog has rabies. I'm like, I'm assuming it doesn't have rabies. Like, rabies isn't that common.
Did it have a collar with tags?
No, it was just foaming at the mouth. But like, I figured nothing to worry about.
Yeah, you can't really tell at that point then.
No, you can't, because you can't see if he was smiling or not.
Right.
But, you know, luckily, a full moon passed. I didn't turn into a werewolf.
That's good.
You know, I cleaned out the wounds and everything like that. But, you know. Other than that little mishap, it was fun.
Good. How long were you gone for? Like 4 days?
Yeah, went from Thursday and got back Sunday.
Good. You had a good time.
Yeah, it's like 4 days. It was good.
You needed it.
It was relaxing.
I am off work from the other job for the week.
Uh-huh.
So I tried to do some relaxing stuff. I've been trying to catch up on movies that I haven't seen. But for the most part, since it's only nice for a few days and it's going to be raining for the rest of the week, I've been doing house repairs. So I've been I've been outside fixing things that I've never fixed in my life, like gutters. I took out the gutter guards that were in there for the last few years, ripped them all out, put new gutter guards in, and then realized that they're supposed to line up perfectly together, right? I put them in. They're solid vinyl gutter guards, and I put them all in and I line them up and they're not lining up correctly. Like, one's a little bit higher or lower than the other. So I go over to Home Depot and then I ask them, hey, I have these vinyl gutter guards that I bought from you guys. Is there any kind of brace or something that goes in the middle of them to lock them together? What have you? And they said, no, they're supposed to just line up. I said, well, they're not doing that. And the guy just looks at me and goes, well, why don't you buy the really big one that's all one piece? I said, because it's 20 feet and I can't fit it in the car.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just not going. So I had to buy
a big piece.
Yeah, I had to buy it in sections. So he said, you'll probably need some kind of adhesive. Cool. What kind of adhesive? Oh, I don't know. You have to go. It's down there and you have to ask somebody. I don't know what's with Home Depot. There's always people on the floor and nobody's in the department that they're supposedly the specialist in. And they always ask you to find somebody else. And then when you find somebody else, they don't know either. I went through to the fourth person before I got somebody over there who knew anything about adhesives and glue and all that nonsense. And we figured out which one I was going to get. So I got this clear silicone that's pretty much weather resistant for extreme temperatures and also dries in 30 minutes. So
nice.
Now I have that, and I'm gluing vinyl gutter guards together while on a ladder, and it's extremely windy this week because we didn't get
fall off the ladder, Eric. That's how like all like major injuries happen. People like on a ladder in the wind, you know, Monty's going to come by and hit the ladder and you're going to fall on the dog. Like, don't do it.
Well, my luck is I'll be on the ladder in the high wind balancing, trying to put everything together, and a random bullet will just hit me. It'll have nothing to do.
That's exactly what will happen. That's what it's going to be.
Right.
So it's going to be some squirrels going to drop a stick on your head from the tree, and you're going to be like, what the fuck was that? And then you're going to fall.
Yeah. So at the beginning of the week, we got the remnants of that blizzard that was hitting the Midwest. We didn't get the snow. We got some of the rain, but a lot of the wind. It was pretty bad.
It was windy.
It was pretty bad. And so I was balancing between, all right, it's sunny. It's not raining right now. I can go out and do this, but it's extremely windy. So it was just quite an ordeal. Got most of it done. Not all of it done, because then it was starting to rain on and off. And I said, you know what? Screw it. Oh, I can wait till next week to do all of these things, because I thought it was going to be nice. Last week, we had 60s and 70s for a few days, and it was nice to go out and do something, but I was working. I couldn't go out and do what I needed to do. So I was like, all right, I'm off next week. It'll be sunny a couple of days. It's been pretty cold the last few days. It's not the weather I thought. And now, like today, I walked outside. I said, nope, it's drizzling. I'm not dealing with this. Went right back inside.
Yeah, the last week has been really confusing, because it's been like nice days where it's 70 and then it's like 40 again. So like, I'll leave in the morning and I go outside and I'm like, nope, I can't wear shorts. I go back and change into pants. And then other days I wear pants and I go outside and I'm like, oh, no, this is shorts weather. So it's just all over the place.
Lousy smarch.
Ugh, it is lousy smarch weather, even though it's Smaprel.
Moving on. So one of the things I tried to do this week was, I'm not going to make dinner. Going to do something nice. I'm not just going to do a quick fix or order in. I'm going to make a proper dinner, if you will. So I decided I'm going to go get some lobster. Right? So
that's a proper dinner. I'm going to make a proper dinner. Lobster.
Yes.
That's like that's the craziest thing. I never even think about getting lobster. I'm never like, I'm going to make the proper dinner. I'm going to go get a lobster.
Right. So I decided
dinner's like, you get like a chuck steak or something. You get some broccoli. You throw it in the oven. You make like a proper meal. You got a lobster.
Right. So I decided to go.
Like Frank Grimes.
You've never been?
Never been?
So I said, all right, I'm going to go get a lobster. And my area doesn't really have a seafood store. You know, just a place that's totally dedicated to seafood. So the supermarkets have decent seafood. So I got to go to one of those. So I go to the first one that I usually go to. I go back to the seafood department. There's a lady there who's starting to clean up the seafood area. It's about 7 p.m. The store doesn't close for a while, but she's already, you know, halfway cleaning up the entire seafood department. Like, she's closing already. So I was like, this is weird. So I walk up to the counter and she turns and looks at me and she's like, huh? Like, can I help you? Which I could already tell this was not going to go well.
Yep.
Said, hello, I'd like to get a lobster steamed, please. Because a lot of these places, you can pick the lobster out of the tank and they'll steam it for you. They'll season it for you. They'll do all of those things. So I said, okay, I'd like to get a lobster steamed, please. And she said, it's a little bit late in the day to be getting lobster. I said, it's 7 o'clock. She goes, I'm already halfway. I've been closing here. She said something like they were doing something at 7:45 and I'm trying to close early and you're preventing me from doing that. And I'm staring at her now wide-eyed after she said, you're preventing me from closing up early. I'm looking at her and I go, are you serious? And she kind of goes, oh. She goes, well, do you still want this? And I said, nope, I'm good. And she looked at me and she goes, you're sure? Yep. Turned around, walked away. Said, not dealing with this. So I do something I don't normally do. I walked all the way to the other side of the store and I asked to see the manager.
Oh, geez. And you did it.
So the manager comes out. Nice, you know, older Italian guy. I say, hello, sir. I shop at your store quite often. And I feel bad that I have to do this. I've never had a problem in your store ever, but I just went down to the seafood department to get a lobster and the lady told me otherwise, that I was preventing her from cleaning up and closing early and that it was a little too late in the day to order a lobster. And he's starting to look at me like he's getting mad. So I thought I did something, like he's mad at me. He pulled, and now this is such an old man move. He unbuttons his dress shirt. Right.
Yeah.
And pulls his arm, the fold back. Up, yeah. Right. And looks at his watch. He has a really nice gold watch. Looks at his watch and he goes, are you kidding me? I said, no. Like, I thought he was mad at me. And he goes, We're not even close to closing. I said, I know. This is what she told me. I said, if you walk back there, the seafood department's almost pretty much packed away. And he's just kind of mad. So I still think he's mad at me. And he goes, this is unacceptable. We're not going to do it. He goes, you still want the lobster? I said, no, actually, I really don't want the lobster. I just wanted to make you aware of this situation here. I've never had a problem in your store, but for the lady to kind of sass me and give me shit about that she was trying to close early and I'm preventing her from doing that and it's a little too late in the day to order it, I just said it wasn't cool. It just seemed inappropriate. And he said, all right, I'm going back there to talk to her. And he goes, this is unacceptable. He points to this other lady that's there and he says, give him a card. And he says, she's going to give you a card. You come back tomorrow. I'll give you, you free seafood. Okay, cool. Thank you very much. I just wanted to bring it to your attention. I didn't want to even go back there and get it now because I'm not going to walk back there with him while he's yelling at her. Yeah. So she gives me the card and I go to leave. So I figured, you know what? The other supermarket's not too far from here. I'll go down there and get it. So I go down there. I walk to their seafood department. They have lobsters. There's a guy sort of cleaning up too. And I said, oh man, this is just in my night. But he was very nice and helpful. And I said, I'd like to get a lobster, please, steamed. Okay. Do you want Old Bay with it? Yeah, let's do that. So they steam it with the Old Bay, right? So he's like, all right, come back in about 5 minutes. And I looked at him. I said, usually steaming a lobster takes at least 10 minutes or so, right? He's like, nah, just about 5 minutes, it'll be fine. Okay, so I go do some other shopping, come back to him. I kid you not, I was there, he said 5 minutes. I was there maybe 7 minutes, right? It was already bagged sitting on the counter. And I said, one, I looked in, it didn't feel that hot, but it felt warm. I looked in real quick and it was red. So I just assumed, okay, check out, leave, get home. Put it on the counter, cut it open. And as soon as I crack it down the middle, all the guts come out like water. It just yep. oozes out this gray sand. And I was like, it shouldn't be doing this. And I try to crack the tail and try to pull everything out. The meat's not fully cooked. I mean, this thing was horrible. The shell wasn't even really red. It was sort of red, but not really. And just covered in Old Bay seasoning. So I dumped the whole plate back into the bag. Run back to that supermarket, and this is the second supermarket, second lobster issue. I walk.
You're gonna be in the newspapers, the lobster guy. They like, this guy and his lobster problems.
Right. All I wanted was the lobster harmonica, and it just didn't work out that way.
Oh, so close.
So I get to the customer service center at this place, and I said, "Hello, how are you doing? Can I speak to a manager, please?" Manager comes out. This manager, did you ever see the show Wings on NBC? It used to be on after Cheers. Yeah. So there's a guy, I think his name was Roy, who ran the airport. He was like the manager or the whatever for the airport. Kind of a big guy, a bit round, wears a giant suit, sports coat, right? Uh-huh. With the hair kind of slicked back. And this is what this guy looks like as he comes out from the manager's office. Very nice. And I just keep thinking, it's Roy from Wings. So I'm talking to him and I said, look, I just had this problem. The guy back there was very nice, but I brought the lobster home, cut it open. It just oozed out. It doesn't look right. He takes the bag, pulls the plastic from the big, it's like a paper insulated, the thick paper uh-huh. insulated bag, takes pulls the something out, looks at it and goes, oh my God, no, and throws it back into the bag. He goes, this isn't good at all. And he says, the guy that's back there working was a trainee for the seafood department. He worked in a different department. We just moved him over there, but apparently he needs more training. I said, I wasn't trying to get the guy in trouble. I just wanted to tell you that this lobster was not cooked. So he's like, do you want to get another one? No, at this point, nope, cutting my losses. Just give me the refund. So he refunds me everything. I go home.
Did you get a coupon for a lobster?
No, he gave me the money back. So instead, like the other guy, I didn't even
get... You could have got two lobsters out of this deal, Eric.
Well, I already paid for this one. The first one I didn't even get, so I didn't pay for anything.
Yeah, that's true.
So I said, screw it, I'm not going to do lobster. I stop at this Italian deli, not that far from me, and I get their chicken franchise, which I enjoy. Chicken franchise. And I go home, and that's it. So yesterday, I go back to the first supermarket And I see the guy walking around. I walk over and introduce myself. And I said, you said this car? And he goes, oh, yes, no problem. Brings me over. There's an older guy there who I've seen before. Takes care of everything. I have this huge lobster. It was almost a 2-pound lobster. And came back in like 10, 15 minutes from doing some other shopping. He was all done, bagged, ready, with the paid sticker on it, saying it's on us. Don't, sorry about that. And he said, I noticed when you left yesterday, all you had were Oreos. He's like, was that your dinner? And I started laughing. I said, no, I just, because I bought the Game of Thrones Oreos.
Yeah.
For the consumer review. And he said, well, I made her feel bad. He's laughing at this. I'm feeling bad, but I'm laughing at the same time. He goes, I made her feel bad. He's like, oh, he's like, the poor guy wanted a lobster. He goes home and now he's having Oreos for dinner. Like, this guy's all right. So, yeah, had the big bag, a 2-pound lobster, free of charge. Thank you so much. It was not the time the other day to go get any kind of lobster. The lobster god, the seafood, Aquaman was against me. The seafood gods were against me. So that is my little lobster tale. Pun.
Ha 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 ha. But see, this is your problem. You should have went for a proper meal. You should have went to a seafood restaurant and just got the lobster. Like, how much cheaper was it to get at the supermarket versus just going to a restaurant and getting one?
Supermarket would have been anywhere, if you get like a pound and a half lobster, anywhere from $13 to $17.
Okay. But restaurant, you get it done right. At the other place. Like, yeah. I never get like a lobster at a supermarket. That's weird.
Why? I mean, I'd go to an official seafood place if there was anyone near me, but there's
none. How is there not near? You're in New Jersey.
Yeah, but at least if the towns around me, as far as I know, I'm not aware of like a traditional seafood market.
Is there any like Italian restaurants? They usually have decent seafood.
The ones around me do not have any seafood.
That diner we went to? You get the lobster diner. I saw that, you know, the diner lobster. I saw that bit on Saturday Night Live.
The diner lobster. It's a club sandwich with a toothpick between three pieces of bread and a full lobster uncooked.
Exactly.
And disco fries.
Ooh, I want disco fries with lobster on it.
So I skipped the lobster.
Well, that's what you get for going to a supermarket for a steamed lobster.
I've never had a problem. I've gone for years. Never had a problem ever. They'll cook everything for you. You just have to ask.
You like pinchy, just like, oh.
No, sometimes
I want it this way.
Sometimes they have king crab legs, and it's like $25 a pound for the king crab leg. So you usually get like two legs in a claw because more of the meat is in the claw.
But what about like Costco? Like, they have like a decent seafood section. Don't you have like a Costco near you?
There's
like
a Costco near me, but it's constantly crowded. There's a lot of
their seafood section is usually pretty good.
Yeah, but there's a lot of families that go to this Costco on group outings that take up the parking lot, that take up all the room in the Costco. Plus, this Costco has a gas station where the gas is cheaper than everywhere else. So it's just completely mobbed all the time. So I just don't even bother going there. What I do sometimes is over in Secaucus, there's a Sam's Club right next to the Walmart in one big complex. And I'll go there.
They're all the same company.
Right. And sometimes they have their seafood already bagged and tagged, ready to go. You go in there and you get a bag of crab claws, snow crab, lobster tails.
Yeah, shrimps, all that shit.
They got it all ready to go. If I want to make it's only like 15 minutes, but sometimes you know, it's late at night. You don't really want to just run all the way out there to get it. So you go with what's in the area. But I digress. Free lobster the next day. All taken care of. But nothing can ever go smooth for me. It's almost as bad as my movie ordeals.
Yeah, always as bad as your movie ordeals.
Moving on. Other stuff from this week. Lots in the news. Notre Dame burnt down.
Well, part of it did.
Yeah, everybody was going crazy, attaching themselves to it, tweeting out, I was there once back in the 90s. We went on vacation. Here's my photo of me in front of the Notre Dame Cathedral. That means nothing. Who cares?
Yeah, like the amount of people who were just like rushing to post their vacation pictures. I was like, man, I've never been to France.
I know. Now you're Euro shaming Gittles.
Dude, the funniest one was and like I don't mean the, like that the church like burning was funny by any means, but there was an Onion headline that came out, and it just had Jesus running into the church, and he just said, "Out of my way, out of my way. My crown of thorns is in there. Jesus, out of my way." And he's just pushing cops out of the way. And I thought that was really funny.
Well, I had no idea, like, because I know it's...
I didn't know that that was there either.
I had no clue. I know it's probably, next to the Vatican, it's probably the most famous cathedral in the world.
Oh, yeah, it's huge.
And they were talking about... Well, I'll go through the rundown here, because they were talking about some of the artifacts and works of art and sculpture and stuff that were all in there. That cathedral...
But it was all removed a couple of days earlier, though.
Most of it was, yes. It was, yeah. That cathedral was almost a museum, the way they had everything there and on display. And I've never been there, so I wasn't aware of all the works that it contained. So if you haven't been anywhere in the world and done nothing, you would not know what was going on. But by, what was it, Monday, 1-2 o'clock on the East Coast here in the United States, everybody in the world knew that Notre Dame was burning. And at a certain point, it's not a steeple, it's a spire, I think it's called the spire, collapsed. And I saw some comments when that they were showing the video of it collapsing. I get what they were saying, but it was the wrong comparison. I saw people, when I was looking for the video of the spire collapsing, people were saying it kind of reminded them of 9/11. And I said,
no.
You're seeing a building burn and fall over, so that's the only thing I can kind of get. Everything else has nothing to do with 9/11 and that church burning down, which was really bizarre that people were even making that comparison. It was horrible to see, but you know what? Nobody was in that spire. Nobody got killed by the spire. It was not a disaster by gigantic proportions in that city.
It could have been a lot worse.
It could have been a lot worse. And say it did happen to burn the entire thing down. It's isolated on an island, right? Yeah. So the fire wouldn't have jumped. It would have burnt everything on that little island, but it wouldn't have jumped and caused a huge, catastrophe for the city of Paris. It's like for New York, it would be if the cathedral was on Roosevelt Island. It's right near.
I don't think that was a concern, though. I don't think a concern was that it was going to like spread anywhere. I think the concern was that it was going to spread through the rest of the church and not just that one area.
I was listening to 1010 Winds on my drive back, the news talk radio station in the New York City area, where they were talking about it live. And that was some of the reports that they were saying, that they were worried that the fire was going to spread to other buildings. I had no idea that the cathedral was even on an island till much later in the day when I was watching the network news reports about everything that has to do with it. But people just jump to conclusions the second something happens.
Oh, yeah.
So anyway, so the spire collapsed. The roof apparently was made of what they were calling ancient timber. Old timey wood. That all burnt up.
900 years old.
And that all burnt up. But fortunately for the church and the city, the towers were okay. The main parts of the actual church itself, where the altar was perfectly fine. There was stuff that collapsed in on pews in the center area. But for considering how bad that fire looked to what the damage actually was sort of a miracle that it was as tame, that they managed to salvage as much as they did. Here's the other stuff I had no idea, which gets to the crown. So they have all these old statues that are all on top of the roof of that cathedral. And they were like 18th century works of art, like steel, like pretty much the same material that they made the original Statue of Liberty statues, the first two that they made. That material was what was making these sculptures and statues that were on the top of the cathedral. And they were removed days before they were cut down so that they could be repaired and restored and then eventually remounted to the church. So they were gone. You had some pieces of artwork that were damaged. But considering some of the old historical stuff, like I didn't realize the story about Napoleon, that's where he took the crown from the Pope. It was at that church there and declared himself emperor and ruler of the church at that point in time. The artwork that reflected that was in there, but that was okay. Some of the firefighters that got in there, when they realized there was nobody in the building, started breaking the display cases and the doors to locked rooms and everything, and just started wrapping pieces of artwork and sculpture and stuff and running them out there as if it was people.
That's crazy.
Which, yeah, I don't know if they would do that in America. You know, if St. Patrick's Cathedral in Manhattan was burning, right, and they realize nobody's in the building, do you think any of those firefighters are going to go in there and try to save, you know, golden crosses and works of art and of that, all those things?
I don't know. I think they'd be more concerned putting that fire out.
Right. It doesn't seem likely. But to the credit of some of the Paris Fire Department, they went in there and were taking all these priceless works of art from history, wrapping them out there. They had them wrapped in blankets as if they were carrying, you know, children out into the street, putting it out there. And the people out on the street were helping out too by, you know, just keeping an eye on stuff. It was amazing to see a city come together like that, because I don't think that kind of charity, goodwill, all that stuff would have happened in Manhattan, in cities in the United States, just for statues and pieces of art.
Yeah, I mean, who knows? I mean, like, they might have something better in place in the city here with, like, fire protection and shit like that to prevent stuff, you know.
Right.
Protect things. Because I know, like, at the museums in D.C., they have, like, special cases that everything's in that's, like, fire-resistant and, like, hurricane-proof and, you know, like, the original documents and shit like that are not going to be destroyed.
Now, some of, okay, good thing there. So, documents. Down in the Smithsonian, they have an original copy of one of the copies of the Declaration of Independence.
Yeah.
It's museum tinted glass so that sunlight and UV can't destroy it. They also suck all the air out of it, so it's a vacuum. Yep. And I found out that's what they do for certain displays at the Smithsonian. When they have Fonzie's jacket, Archie Bunker's chair, they're in these glass cases where the air is sucked out so that it doesn't age. And it doesn't...
Yep. Because the air will just, like, destroy it after a while.
So, back to Notre Dame. So, one of the more interesting things with the fire was that there was a portion of the thorn crown supposedly worn by Jesus Christ was there in a display at the church. I had no idea that existed.
Yeah, same here. Why aren't we doing DNA tests on that shit? Why aren't we cloning Jesus? What is up with this?
You want Jesus clones?
I think it'd be hilarious. Let's bring him back. He's like, oh, geez, what'd you guys do? But he doesn't say, oh, geez, this is on me. What'd you guys do?
I think technically the reason they don't go through DNA and clone Jesus, because when Jesus returns, it's supposed to be the apocalypse. Isn't that right? When Jesus returns to Earth, it's supposed to be, you know, Revelations.
I don't know. Isn't that this week? Isn't it like Easter and like Passover and all that shit's this week?
No. I mean, return again, not from death to in the biblical sense where he died, suffered, died, was buried.
And oh, you
on
mean
the third
like,
day rose again.
I think there are people of a certain sect of religion that believe that when he comes back, it's because of Armageddon.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I think that's even in the
Catholic teachings. That's what Mike Pence believes, but yeah. There was a whole documentary on Vice about that.
Well, I got a chance to see on NBC News, they had a photo or some video of the Crown of Thorns. And I'm looking at it, and I did think exactly what you think. It's like, what, did they ever DNA test this? Did they ever carbon date test this?
Any of that shit? I'm sure they have.
Maybe there's follicles of Jesus' hair in there so that you have... Imagine 23andMe, if they had Jesus' DNA off follicles from that crown, and they now have proof that you were traced back to Jesus' lineage.
I mean, I've heard crazier conspiracy theories.
Right, but now you could actually prove it.
But wasn't that like part of like the Da Vinci Code or something like that? Wasn't something like trying to figure out like Jesus' lineage? Wasn't that part of that movie?
I think you're right. You know, I have those too, and I've watched the first one.
What if that's what 23andMe was? It was just a giant like DNA test being run to try and find out who were the descendants of famous people throughout the world.
So, okay, so it's a search for the new Jesus, is what you're saying.
Or anybody. Be like, oh, you're related to, you know, the Pharaoh, or you're related to, you know, this king or something like that, and they're just tracking all the DNA so they know where these people are.
Doesn't that fall into preacher territory?
Yeah.
Yeah. Preacher had
members. This is a conspiracy theory. This isn't what's happening. This is something I'm making up because it sounds hilarious.
I know. It could be. If you haven't read the graphic novel Preacher or seen the TV show on AMC, there's a storyline in there that they're trying this religious identity outside of the church but works with the church. is trying to find a new messiah, a public messiah, to put out in front of the world because the lineage of Jesus Christ did not hold up well, and the person who is now supposedly the messiah is, yes, supposedly a little low on the gene pool.
Oh, yeah.
And
that's a great scene in the book.
It is. So if they traced a crown, if they do 23andMe on the Thorn of Crowns, you have a follicle of Jesus' hair or blood. That thing was scalped into his head, so he was bleeding. You got the DNA there. You could trace it back and then put those results into the 23andMe database and see who actually really is, you know, the great times 19 son of God.
Yeah. Who is it? And then they do it, and it's just like, oh, it's just this homeless guy. Like, oh, fuck him.
It's some YouTuber.
But you see, but then someone would have to, like, mix it up with, like, you know, the Jurassic Park footage and, like, the dinosaur hatching out of the egg, but then, like, Jesus' head pops through.
That is a bit weird. But that could also go back into the Notre Dame display of relics.
Yeah, Jesus' eggshell.
So there was the Thorn of Crowns, and then there was something else. I think
Crown of Thorns.
Crown of Thorns, Thorn of Crowns, whatever.
A Thorn of Crowns would be way different. That would be so much cooler. Like, oh, look at my rosebush. Oh, don't hurt yourself on all the crowns.
That is true.
Off of it. Oh, yeah, it's lots of tiaras and crowns everywhere.
The Crown of Thorns was the big to do. Everybody was worried about that. But then there were supposedly some other golden crosses and other stuff from the time of Jesus that were also in that church. Which is, now I'm fascinated by it, because now I want to see like a documentary of what actual works and pieces were in that church before all this fire.
You probably don't need to go to do a documentary. You probably just go to Wikipedia and just like read what was there.
I'll have to
see something funny where like there was a Twitter post where someone was trying to be like, this whole church burns, but like the golden cross stayed, and that's a proof of a miracle, and no one can explain that. And then like some guy like tweeted on there, and he was just like, yeah, it's because gold has a higher melting point than wood. That's why it didn't melt.
Also, that photo, I know what you're talking about, where it's across the church where you see the rubble, and then there's the altar, and there's the church. I saw that too, and also somebody said that's the flash reflecting off the gold. It wasn't glowing. It was just, you know, I don't know if it was like Getty or AP or somebody in there to take an official photo of the thing, and that the reason why the gold was glowing was just the lights reflecting from the flashes of the cameras.
Yeah.
So that all happened. And then also, too, before we get off of this, people were jumping to conclusions that because France had issues in the past with terrorism, that this must be Muslims doing it. And this was a whole attempt at, you know, an attack on the church or attack on the people of France.
The only people who said that were extreme right wing people on fucking Twitter. Dude. No reputable person was saying that.
It was the same. I'm just saying it was the same time when I was in the car and they're saying that they were worried about fire jumping from building to building, and I didn't know it was on an island yet. Same time, people just started, oh, there's a huge fire at a landmark. This is what's happening. People just throwing it out there to kind of bait and flood social media with that opinion. And it turns out not to be that, because what they believe, they haven't 100% confirmed it, but they
said it was an electrical fire.
Yeah, it was an electrical shortage because they had all that scaffolding up there and all the renovations, that it was such old wiring that something just didn't hit. And that's why it took a couple hours for it to actually ignite. And then once it ignited, that old wood just went up like kindling. You know? Yeah,
but it's also like, it's extremely dangerous to have people like Glenn Beck going on, you know, the news and being like, you know, Muslim terrorists did the, you know, if you find out that, if they even found out that Muslim terrorists did this, you're not going to know. The media won't tell you. So like,
he said that?
Yeah, he fucking said that, dude. He said that even if they did this, the media won't tell you. So that leaves it up to, now people won't even believe that's an electrical fire because they're already planting in your head that they did it, and it's just so ridiculous.
Well, that crazy that was the point. Well, not his point, but the point I was making was on Monday when all this was going down early on, people were just throwing all this stuff out there, so you didn't know what was fact and what was real. And then that's how they get you when they're saying the media won't tell you. But yeah, the media won't tell you sometimes because that's not the case. You're just throwing this stuff out there just to attach your name to the to the travesty, to the, you know, because the world's watching this and trying to figure out. So you're trying to throw your name in there to try to get some kind of credibility or
no,
boost your
awareness.
No,
they're throwing it out there to, it's because it's propaganda, dude. Like, you can't, it's not because his name's attached to it. It's because that's what they want people to believe.
Right, but
that's why they say that. It doesn't matter if Glenn Beck. I saw other people saying it too. Like, but it was more of like, and I saw other people commenting. They're like, "Yo, you know, you should probably wait a little bit before you start saying stuff like this because it makes us all look fucking crazy."
Yeah, I'm not denying that, but it's also that they try to get their name attached to these things, even though they're throwing out conspiracy theories. Why are they also they doing? They're trying to push an agenda. Yes, but
yeah,
also
1,000%. That's exactly
right, push
what
an agenda, but also. Outside of pushing the agenda, the other agenda is to have their name attached so that people want to call and talk to them, you know, as a pundit or interviews or something. What do you think your theory is? What do you think this is? Like, so they can do that. It's always the root of everything is always to try to attach yourself to something, whether you should be attached to it or not.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't know in this case if that's it. I don't know if I'd want my name attached to falsely accusing an electrical fire on Muslim terrorists because fucking Notre Dame burned down. Yeah. Because just because it was a Catholic church. You know, that's it's straight up propaganda, Eric.
All right, moving on. I also last week, since we didn't do a regular show, not last week, the week before, I was at WrestleMania 35 at the Meadowlands in New York, New Jersey. What?
Everyone I knew was there except for me.
Yeah, that was weird this time. There seemed to be a lot more people who were going to WrestleMania who I knew were not wrestling fans, but were just going because it was a major live event.
Yeah, that's it. It's a spectacle type thing. Like, I like to go to things that are like stuff like that. Like, I'll go to concerts for bands I don't like if I know they put on a crazy show. You know what I mean? I think it's that kind of thing.
Well, good. Keep that in mind because I want to talk to you about Coachella next. But I went to WrestleMania 35.
I'm not going
to
go to that, though.
Not me either. I went to WrestleMania 35. It was great. Got a parking spot right up near the stadium. Got in. Had really good tickets right behind the ring. So when I was looking at the ring, but on the other side of the ring was the ramp of and the stage where everybody came down. Dude, this spectacle, and I've loved WrestleMania since it started, and I've been to three of them. This spectacle was the longest that it's ever been, because it's not just a 4 hour, because back in the day, the WWE pay-per-views were 2 to 3 hours at most, and then WrestleMania was the big deal, so it was a 4 hour pay-per-view, right? In the last few years, they've added pre-show stuff to it, so 5 to 7 p.m. East Coast time are the pre-show stuff and pre-show matches. So you have interviews, you have packages, little vignettes that are showing you the history of the matches leading up to this event. Then you have other matches that they can't fit into the main card that are in the pre-show. Then the show starts at 7 o'clock and usually goes to 11, but then it has to go, it's been going to midnight, almost midnight the last couple of years. By 9 o'clock, I did something I don't normally do. If I go to a live event at all, usually I stay. But at this point, I go, you know what? I think I kind of want to bail. And the people I was with was like, do you want to just go? Everybody said, yeah. So we left. Got out, walked out of the stadium, had the network on my phone so I could still watch what was going on. We got in the car, got home, dropped everybody off. I was home by 10:15. Mm-hmm. And I said, all right, cool. This is still going to go to, and I forgot that it goes to midnight. So I'm thinking 11. I'm watching it on TV at home and it's going past 11. I go, oh, right. It goes to midnight. Then more matches kept coming and coming. I said, when is they going to get to the big deal for this year's WrestleMania was the first time that a women's event was going to headline the show. So that would be the big event at the end that would close out the whole program. Wasn't coming. Now it's 12 o'clock and they still haven't gotten to the three-way women's championship match. This thing didn't end till 12:30.
Yeah.
And it started at 5. And all I kept thinking is past 11 o'clock, I said, the amount of union fees that they have to pay because
oh my
it's
God,
past,
so expensive.
Right, because they have to pass, because it goes past 11 o'clock and now it's past midnight and they're still broadcasting. They're still doing all this stuff. So
and like people for people who don't know, like if you're in the union for like TV and shit like that, when you go into overtime stuff like that, it is ridiculously expensive.
It is. That's why
you have to pay like penalties for every half hour to an hour you go over.
You pay overtime.
You Yeah, pay overtime, and then you have to give, once you start going overtime, you have to start giving more breaks and stuff like that. Then you have to give extra break time. Like, it just gets, it becomes such a mess.
Right, and that comes at the cost of the person, not the venue. If you go past the venue's time, that comes at the cost of the promoter who's running the event. So after 11 o'clock, WWE has to pay all that extra money for the union stuff that's going on at MetLife Stadium. So 12:30, they had to pay from 11 to 12:30. Thing ends. I'm home. I'm glad I'm home. I was like, man, I don't have to fight out of that parking lot and get home and whatever. Next day, I'm hearing on the news and I see some stuff online. It was a total shit show trying to get out of MetLife Stadium because New Jersey Transit stopped running at 11.
It was a Sunday.
Yeah, they weren't running at the extended hour times. And had so apparently had WWE just told the Jersey Transit that they were still running till about 12:30 or something, they would the representative I heard on there, they would have kept running the trains. It would have cost overtime, would have cost WWE, but they still would have done it, right?
Mm-hmm.
They had no notice. So they went to their overnight schedule for the weekends, which was once an hour, maybe twice an hour. So you have all these people that took the train there and took buses there thinking, oh, it's great, I don't have to drive. Now you're going to leave. You have no buses. And the train's coming once an hour. So people didn't get home till like 3 in the morning.
Dude, I had friends who didn't get home till 5:30 in the morning.
From WrestleMania?
Yeah, because they had to go all the way from Jersey all the way to Bushwick. You know what I mean? Like, that's a trip on public transit. So, like, now you're late because of the New Jersey Transit. Now the subways aren't running. So it's just like, you just get delayed. But all my friends who went this year took the Monday off from work. So they didn't have to go in. But they all got sick. Every single person got sick from the public transit and, I guess, from being at WrestleMania.
Wow.
Like, concrete, you know? It's just too many people. You get fucking sick.
Yeah, but... See, I was fortunate enough because I was able to walk in and out and I had, you know, clear shot in and out and had good seats, which is the ideal situation for anybody. But most people don't have that ability to get those things, or I'll even say the privilege of having that, you know, or being connected to it. When you got to go to events like this is why I stopped going to even concerts in general, because of the madness of this thing. Because if you stay to the end and then they do an encore, and sometimes they do a second encore, and you're there really late, if you're taking mass transit, it's a pain in the ass. If you're parked in the parking lot there, nobody knows how to drive in an orderly fashion. Everybody just kind of goes, man, it looks like a scene from The Simpsons, and every car is in every which direction. And then you're sitting there for hours while people are still tailgating because they know they can't get out of the parking lot, or they're doing drunk, you know, throwing beer bottles and doing drunk football and all this other stuff, when you're just trying to get home and leave the damn concert because you got to work the next day.
Yeah, fuck that.
I stopped going to live events like this because that was one of the reasons that it's just killed any of the fun you just had in the previous few hours is now gone because of this nonsense, which leads me into Coachella 2019, which is, I think at this point, the biggest music festival in Earth. Is it that big?
But I don't know. It's probably up there.
It's such a trendy thing. It's a place to be seen. And it's, you know, it's been going, I think, like 12 years, 13 years, something like
it's
that.
It's been going for a long time now.
Right. And it just keeps getting bigger and bigger with the names that it was attracting. I think last year's was the biggest one so far because of Beyonce's surprise set at the end of the run. But the thing goes for like a week and a day or something like that. It's an extended event. And this year, it just seems that it's more so than other years. It just seems like rich, popular people go to this thing. You don't see regular people there. Everyone's taking selfies just to be there. I don't know if they're really there to watch these bands, because everybody's social media who's out there is just constantly, like, they'll post not just a photo of them, but there's five or six photos that you're scrolling through. Like, here's me by this Ferris wheel. Here's me by this, you know,
here's me with flowers in my hair.
The Gucci tent. Yeah, you know, here's me with the exclusive Snapchat filter for Coachella. And all these women, whether they're attractive or not, have their asses hanging out. Like, that seems to be the trend this year, is that they have the shorts cut up like a thong. And just their asses are hanging out everywhere.
That's always been the trend, dude.
More, but I think that's the whole thing this year, though. Like, you used to see that stuff. This is every photo now. Even the celebrities that are getting their photos posted, either by themselves or if you see stuff that TMZ or Getty posts, everyone's got their ass hanging out.
The problem with like all these festivals is it just became such a corporate type event. Whereas like they all started as like these like little independent music things. It was like, oh, cool, we're going to go to this thing and, you know, we're going to listen to some bands. We're going to have a good time. And then, you know, the marketers found out about it because of all the social media and everything. And now it's just like you go there and it's just like tents for, you know, brands. And it's so weird. You know, I remember going to like Warped Tour back in the day and like, it was just the band tents and then whoever was selling merch. And that was pretty much it. You know, there wasn't, you know, the Chevy booth or like you said, the Gucci booth and like shit. Ugh.
I'm looking at some of the ticket prices here. Like if you, because it's 2 weeks, it's 2 weekends, right? And then there's activities and stuff through the center of the week. So you get the big headliners on the weekend. So it starts and ends with big bands, and then you have other bands that are playing during the week, smaller yeah. bands or newer artists or what have you. And the weekends are really the big deal for the headlining acts. So for a 2 day pass, just a general admission thing for the weekend stuff starts at $175 a day.
Yeah, no thanks.
Right. And then the other packages they have,
you are not getting $350 worth of music.
Right. For just the 2 days.
For 2 days.
Yeah. So you know you have headliners on that first weekend, but they're not the big headliners, which will be on the second weekend, right? So, yeah. So you have that. They have other passes that start at $429 per pass. They have a section called Vivid for Vivid seats, which are $330 for the weekend for two or $350 for weekend one. StubHub also has their hands on a lot of the tickets and started their prices. Started, not even the $175 if you bought through the Coachella site. Their prices started for just the basic stuff, $350 a ticket. And then SeatGeek, which is another thing like StubHub, has started their tickets at least $372 per pass.
Yeah, that's not worth it. Who's the bands this year? Who's the headliner?
I don't know. I know what happened because as we're recording this, weekend two of Coachella is coming up. But the past weekend, the only ones that I really knew of, I saw all the attention were for one was this girl, Billie Eilish, or Eilish. She's a 17-year-old singer. I don't really know much about her, but apparently people were going crazy for her. And is she a 17-year-old singer? I think, or maybe she started at 17. I apologize. I don't know too much about her. She has songs called Ocean Eyes, Bellyache, You Should See Me in a Crown. I don't know any of these songs. Maybe it's in the color where I left my lover. What an expensive face. V is for Vendetta. I thought that I'd feel better, and now I got a bellyache. She was apparently a big deal as far as social media goes, and the entertainment shows were all about this girl. Apparently, she really loved Justin Bieber, and she talked about it a lot for years, and then he surprised her and met up with her at Coachella, so that was apparently a big deal. I don't know.
I don't trust like any of these stories, these like young kids who just like break into this. I'm like, ugh, who are you made? Who made you? I mean, like, that it was organic.
Yeah.
I believe that like they were hoisted into the spotlight somehow through connections.
Then Ariana Grande was a big headliner for the weekend, and she surprised everybody by having NSYNC come out with her. So that was a big deal for older people and younger people alike. Then Weezer. By the way, it's broadcasting on YouTube. So why would you need to go to this damn thing to be part of this scene, which I don't get why that's important to anybody.
Yeah, but I don't know.
Weezer went out there, and we've talked about Weezer recently in the past. They put out an album called The Teal Album, which is all covers that they did. And their biggest song last summer was Africa by Toto, and they've done some stuff with with Toto. So for this year, for Coachella, they came out there and they did a version of No Scrubs, which is on that album, and Chili from TLC came out and joined them and did the song with them. And then they closed up with Tears for Fears doing Everybody Wants to Rule the World, which sounds kind of cool. Do want to check that out on YouTube?
Okay. I googled this Billie Eilish person, and then I clicked the link, and it turns out that her whole family is actors and producers and everything. I knew it. Figured, called it.
Okay, so she wasn't just a young upstart out of the blue.
No, her brother is a musician, singer, record producer, and actor who's reduced that her whole family is connected. He was on the final season of Glee. So, yeah, just as I figured. Like, there's no way these people never come out from, like, somewhere where there's, like, it's completely organic, where it's, like, they were plucked out of obscurity. It's always some sort of fucking connection. But whatever. That's just me nitpicking.
No,
sorry.
You nailed it. It's not even nitpicking. You nailed it. It's exactly what it is. But I just can't go to, there's no... I get why younger kids would think, like, this is where all the cool people go because of social media. Like, I got to be there. I got to take photos at Coachella and tag that I'm at Coachella and do all this Coachella stuff. It's everything but the actual bands playing.
Yeah.
You know, you never see video clips of the bands playing. You never see photos of the band, or maybe one of the artists happened to be walking around and people are taking photos. You never see that. It's them with flowers in their hair standing by a dumb Ferris wheel with a multiple camera photo shoot, and they're showing these 7 photos I like. Which one do you like the best? Rate my photo. You know,
They probably took like 800 of those photos before they narrowed it down to that one. Just be like, no, wait, hold on. The wind blew a piece of hair in my eye, so I have to take this picture again 75 times.
And here's my David Bowie spaceman outfit that I'm wearing. But look, I cut the crotch out and the area for the boobs, so now it's sexy looking and.
But I mean, who am I to knock people? I went to fucking Warped Tour where everyone had fucking Janko jeans that were wider than, like, you know, a redwood tree and spiked collars. And, you know, everyone looked like what juggalos look like now. But that was the fashion. You know what I mean? But that was what it was in the 90s. Yeah. But like, you know, the 90s never, like, the juggalos never grew out of the 90s. They stayed. The outfits stayed. The look stayed. The time stayed.
They're wearing the girls are wearing the chokers.
Yeah, exactly. But I think of just, like, you know, all the stupid things that, like, people wore when we went to shows. Just we didn't have the social media. I'm sure if we had social media back then and we were looking at all those pictures, it would be like, oh, look how fucking stupid we are. You know what I mean?
Well, people do have photos that they took with their disposable 35mm cameras, and they do post them up on social media and go, look at us back. And it's always, you know.
Oh, it's cringy.
6 dudes and 2 girls sort of sitting on a couch with beers, and they're having a great time. And it's like they all look.
Everyone's got like the bleached, like blondish hair, yep. And, like the beaded collar, and like almost tan, but not tan.
Frosted tips, a lot of Hot Topic. Yep.
Yeah. Hot Topic.
On the plus side, though, this coming weekend for the final 2 days of Coachella, there's a heat advisory alert that it's supposed to jump over 100 degrees for both days. So I could not be happier with hearing
that's
that
actually
news.
Not good. That's really dangerous, but hopefully people will be okay.
I'm not going to.
The problem
to that.
Is people go to these shows and they do a lot of drugs like Molly and shit, and you can't do that in the sun. And young people always end up fucking overdosing because they don't know, because they're 20 and they just fucking take it. So hopefully they'll be okay.
It is horrible, but also it's thinning the herd. If they're that dumb, then
Some people are stupid.
They are stupid. Let's do an abbreviated version of TV and movies, and then we got to take a break because then we got to get to our pal Epic Lloyd from Epic Rap Battles of History. Looking at the box office from last week, coming in at number one was Shazam, which I still have to go see. I've heard
Shazam.
A lot of mixed reviews.
Pyle. I said, Shazam. Pyle. Shazam.
That never gets old. So I posted Pyle. That people said that it wasn't that good, and I had one guy who was furious with me, saying, "I heard it was good. Who do you talk to? Who do you know that's shitting on this thing? It's an amazing movie, and your friend don't know comic book movies." And I said, "Dude, relax. It's just a movie. I was told by some credible people they didn't really care for it. That's all I'm saying. I probably will go see it, but I'm just saying I don't have my expectations up. They're usually not as good as Marvel movies, and that is just a fact." Anyway, so Shazam came in at number one. Number two, some movie called Little, which I'm not familiar with. But number three, which I was surprised it was even this high, did not make a lot of money. The reboot of Hellboy made.
I think people were going to hate watch it because it was so bad.
It made just about $12 million.
Hey, good for them. They made something.
How much
did it cost?
I could tell you right now.
I guarantee you the advertising was probably more than $12 million.
Ooh. Okay, this is the production budget for Hellboy the reboot. $50 million.
Ooh-ee.
That's just the production budget. Tie in with the marketing budget, which I can't find those numbers. But still, opening weekend is not good. It's worldwide take, $15 million.
Oof.
Yeah, not good.
That's not good. That's not good.
Coming in at number four is, in its second week, Pet Sematary, which actually is doing pretty well. It made $45 million worldwide. Why is this button not going back there? And there we go. Number five, Dumbo, the Tim Burton version, live action Disney movie. It's almost at $100 million, so that's doing okay. And, I mean, I get why this is at number six is doing well, because we're getting close to Endgame on April 26th, but Captain Marvel still in the top 10, and it's made $1.6 billion.
That's billion with a TR. That's $1 trillion, Eric.
Two, three. Oh, my God, it is. It made $1 trillion.
No, it didn't. You say doll hairs?
No, it's $1.06 billion.
That's still nothing to
shake a stick at, you know.
And I shake sticks at lots of things. I walk down the street and I'm like,
opening,
shaking sticks.
Opening this weekend in the box office. Call there,
stick shaker.
A movie called Breakthrough, which I'm not familiar with what Breakthrough is about.
I've never even heard of that.
No, who's in this thing?
I don't know. I'd shake a stick at it, though.
Yeah, you better shake a stick at this thing, because I don't know who this movie is. And that's pretty much it for this weekend. Next weekend, I'm not really seeing anything until the 26th for Avengers. So it's a light couple of weeks until we get to Endgame.
So what happens in the Endgame? Is that the one where Thanos, and he does the thing? And then the people are like, oh, no, he did the thing. And they're like,
No, that was Infinity War, and that was last year.
Oh, so now this is the one where, like, Iron Man's going to do the thing. And then Thanos is like, no, don't do the thing. And then it ends.
Yes, but Doctor Strange, not Iron Man.
Dr. Iron Strange Man.
Dr. Iron Strange. There you go.
Dr. Strange Man.
Yeah, so
made of iron.
Avengers Endgame, the latest Marvel movie, opens on April 26th. May 16th, we have John Wick 3.
Ooh.
And May 22nd, Disney's Aladdin live action movie. Ugh. And May 31st, Godzilla King of Monsters, which we have all to look forward to. I watched a couple of movies, caught up on some stuff that everybody else has seen that I have not seen. This has been an ongoing feature with this show. I watched Bumblebee, which was the latest in the Transformers movies.
I heard that was good.
It was very good. I watched it. I enjoyed it. It was probably the best Transformers movie out of all the live action Transformers movies.
Nice.
Yeah. So I actually recommend people, because you see the Transformers, this is a prequel to all the other ones that Michael Bay made. And you see the Transformers back on Cybertron, and they look like the Generation 1 Transformers. They look like
the
they're
ones.
They look like they're supposed to. I was done in a minute 30 seconds into the movie. I could have been done and worth the rental price because they showed Soundwave and he had the right voice. He had the processing and everything. I was like, done. I don't need to see the rest of the movie. That's what I wanted to see. And
so is there a
was.
Soundwave movie coming?
Oh, I'd kill for a Soundwave movie.
Well, you can.
I can crowdfund that. I probably get sued, but I could probably try and do that. So I watched Bumblebee. I watched Gran Torino, which
is the car game?
The Clint Eastwood movie.
Oh, the Get Off My Lawn movie.
Yes.
Yeah, I haven't watched that one.
It was surprisingly good. I did not expect the ending to go the way that it did, but it was actually a good movie. He plays a really good hard ass, stubborn, bigoted person.
that's what he's always played.
It's
Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, but this was just blatantly. It's like, all right, go to town.
It's like him like walking or falling down, rather.
Open the floodgates. Yeah, every name he could possibly use, he used. So, yeah, I saw Gran Torino. I rewatched Scott Pilgrim versus the World for the first time in many years.
Forgot, I like that movie.
Forgot how great that... I knew I always loved that movie, but forgot how great that movie was. And then realized how many fucking people are in that movie. There's a ton of people in that movie who are very popular now. Brie Larson's in there, who's currently Captain Marvel. Who played his girlfriend, Mary Elizabeth Winstead, who played Fiona, Ramona Flowers, who's gorgeous in there. Michael Cera, of course, from Juno, from that Nick and whatever's mixtape
playlist,
Arrested Development. Chris Evans plays the second evil boyfriend. The skateboarder.
Thing is, it's directed by Edgar Wright.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's worth it just for that because he's a great director. And, you know, he did Shaun of the Dead, Hot Fuzz, like all those movies, Baby Driver. And he really, I would say out of like comic book movies, his felt the most like a comic book, even compared to the Marvel ones, where the Marvel ones have like superheroes and you're like, that's cool. This one had like thwop and like page, you know, punches and turns, and the way the camera zoomed, it felt like it was a graphic novel. I mean, it's based on the manga, but I loved it. I thought it was fun.
Yeah, I was so glad I got a chance to rewatch it. It's on Netflix for free. If you have a Netflix subscription, it's for free for you to watch. And then I watched another Netflix thing called The Beyond, which is it's sort of like a futuristic scientific space movie.
Okay.
Where they find like an anomaly outside the Earth's atmosphere. They don't know if it's a black hole or and then they realize it's a wormhole. So they realize they can't send humans through it. So they start experimenting where they try to move human brains and consciousness into these robot kind of bodies and send them into there to try to figure out what's on the other side and what's going on.
Movie or TV show?
It's a movie.
Oh, okay.
It's a movie. Yeah. And I don't want to give any more away with that, but the ending is not what the ending's a little. I think for that kind
is
of movie,
it,
I
is
think
it
that
a Netflix original.
Yeah,
that's why
the end. No, that's not the ending's bad. The ending is a little too positive, I think, for people when you're expecting that it kind of is a happy go lucky thing at the end.
Is it so. Like Contact? And it turns out like that the spaceship like. Ah, oh, jeez.
Yes, it's not exactly Contact, but there's
like that kind of
there's it wraps it up in a way.
Okay,
where you know everybody and that other movie too. What was the other movie a couple of years ago with the aliens where they looked like Squid Ink?
Interstellar.
Remember how
there was no aliens in Interstellar.
No, it wasn't Interstellar then. Interstellar was the Matthew McConaughey movie. This was the other movie where the ship comes down and they get to kind of go into this room where there's like a wall and the aliens are behind this.
Prometheus?
No. Damn it.
The Covenant one?
No.
That was the other alien one.
It wasn't an alien franchise movie. It was this other movie
Arrival?
Where the. That might be.
And they're trying to like learn the language.
Yeah, and it's all like circles and shapes.
Yeah, and then it's behind what looks like a frosted shower door like the whole time.
Yes, that's exactly it. Yeah, it is Arrival.
Yeah, that's the Arrival,
okay.
Yeah.
So you
I
saw,
didn't see that one, but I heard it was okay.
Okay, so it sort of has more of an Arrival ending, if you will.
Okay, yeah, I heard the ending to Arrival wasn't very good.
So, but you like watching these things like I do. So
yeah, I do.
Try The Beyond on Netflix. I also finished season 2 of The Chilling Adventures of Sabrina. I really love this show.
I haven't watched it yet.
I was not expecting to like it as much as I did, but it's more of the later issues of the comic books, and it has nothing to do with like the 90s TGIF sitcom at all. It starts off a little Buffy-ish, like with the Scooby Gang kind of thing, but then quickly goes into its own and becomes very dark. Like, there's a lot of fucked up satanic stuff in it.
Okay.
Yeah. And so I really enjoyed it. It's 2 seasons and a Christmas episode in between the 2 seasons there. And now they just announced season 3 is coming out for October for Halloween. It's really good. I
have to check that out.
And where they're going for season 3, I just read up on it. I'm very excited about it. So you may enjoy it. It seems anybody I've told about, they're like, I don't know. I'm like, no, it's really not this teeny bopper kind of CW Riverdale kind of shit. It really goes into its own direction. It's a lot of dark nonsense. So check that out.
I still have to check out Umbrella Academy. Everyone keeps telling me to watch that, and I hear it's great.
Very good. It was written and I think the screenplay, too, for everything was done by Gerard Way.
Yeah.
Because it was based off his comic book series. He even records original covers. Oh, sorry, not original covers. That makes no sense. He even did his own version of cover songs that were on the soundtrack to the show. So when you're listening to them, it's like, oh, yeah, I know this song. And then you do Shazam to it. Gerard Way. It's like, oh, okay. He did the Turtles, Happy Together. He did a bunch of different songs. So the soundtrack to it is really good. If that alone just is enough to entice you. The soundtrack to Umbrella Academy is really good. So you should check that out.
Check that out.
Also, May 8th, we finally have a release date for Lucifer. I was a big fan of Lucifer when it was on Fox, and then it got canceled, and Netflix picked it up and did what they had to do. Finally, we know season 4 is coming to Netflix on May 8th, and it's supposed to be a bit more adult and darker than what they were doing on broadcast television, which I'm always up for.
Always down for that.
Always down for that. Other TV notes, Game of Thrones opened up the past weekend here. Everybody lost their shit, either saying they were proud that they never watched it, or people going crazy that they did watch it. I was yelling about the Game of Thrones Oreos, which I had mentioned earlier in the show, that they were nothing but a price grab and a gimmick, because they're original Oreos and just the cookies have the different logos for the houses of Westeros there, and that's all it is, and they charge you a dollar more for.
And there's no different flavor or anything.
It's made with. It's original Oreo, original thin, not thin. Sorry, the original size Oreo, original flavor Oreo. It's just the cookie has the different representation of the different houses. That's all it is.
Oh, that's just a gimmick.
April 24th, season 2 of Cobra Kai opening up on YouTube Premium, and this show I'm really interested in, May 31st, which is still another month and a half away, on Amazon Prime, Good Omen, one of the stars.
Oh, season 2, right?
It's Neil Gaiman's project, and it has David Tennant in it. I don't know if it's season 2 or season 1. I think it's starting.
No.
This isn't America.
Last year, this the isn't last 2 years at Comic-Con, there's been Good Omen stuff.
I don't know, because then I'm going to have to go look for it. Because I know Neil was also promoting American Gods, which is currently in its second season and is very good as well. I'm all caught up on that. You should definitely watch it.
Oh, yeah, I guess it is. They were probably just advertising it for the last 2 years. It says it premieres May 31st on Amazon Prime.
Yeah, it looks really good.
It says there's only 6 episodes and they're all going to be released at once.
Great. I'd love to binge it right away. I've been waiting long enough time for that. One other thing, too. Apparently, it's been brought to my attention that I guess after season 7 of Game of Thrones, they said that the handful of episodes that were going to be the final season were going to be longer episodes. So it was going to be like watching a movie every week. And that was not the case. Most of the episodes are under an hour runtime, with 2 of them like an hour 6.
Yeah.
So people were getting upset that they were lied to over that. It's like, well, what do you care? You're getting the
final season. What are you going to do? You're going to get it.
Yeah.
Like, it's going to end.
2 more TV notes and then we will get out of here. The Walking Dead had announced, because there's a lot happened in the last 2 weeks since we've done the show. The Walking Dead announced a third spinoff series that's going to center around female protagonists. Do you know anything about this?
I don't know anything about it because I gave up on the Walking Dead universe. I still read the graphic novel. I love the graphic novel, but I gave up on all the TV versions of it. So I had read about it, and the only thing in my head that I can, that it says is like cash grab. Like, that's all it says. Like, they can't possibly, like, what else are they going to tell? Like, oh no, zombies from another angle. Like, all right, we get it. It's fucking zombies. And then I read something on Twitter the other day that said in this season of Fear the Walking Dead, there's going to be a new zombie, and it's going to change everything for the entire Fear the Walking Dead and Walking Dead universe. And it's the first time anyone's done this with a zombie. And I'm like, if they have a fucking talking zombie or somebody getting cured of this, then that's like super jumping the shark.
What about animal zombies?
I think there has been, maybe. I don't know. Animal zombie would be cool. But I mean, would they attack you? They'd just eat other deer.
No, they would attack anything that's living. Imagine like zombie elephants just storming a city.
I guess the zombies will eat animals. So yeah. I guess. Yeah, well, I guess that's true.
It seems to be the series that everybody... I remember when they were announcing that this show was coming way back in the day, how excited everybody was that the show was coming. And then a few years later, most of the people are like, I'm so tired of this. Yeah, they've rebooted.
It was too much.
They rebooted and restructured Fear the Walking Dead. People have said this past season has been a lot better than it was in the past.
People are saying that that's a better show now, but I haven't kept up on it. I gave up on season two.
I haven't gone back to it. Despite David Brody's protests for me to go back and watch it, I just let it go of the whole
Walking Dead. Oh, David Brody, I feel bad. I used to talk about the Walking Dead with him all the time. I just have it in two seasons now.
Yeah.
I tell you. It's not good.
Final TV news, because we mentioned them earlier. Preacher, one of our favorite shows and a great graphic novel, is ending with the season 4. Now, Seth Rogen tweeted out that it's not canceled, that it's just ending. They're ending the story. Now, what I don't understand is there's a lot more to tell and a lot more to develop with it, but they're ending in season 4, so it didn't make any sense. But then I dug a little deeper and I found out a few days later after his tweet that Seth Rogen and Evan Goldberg, is that his last name?
Mm-hmm.
His partner. They had their offices and their production company and stuff with Sony. They just left and signed a new deal with Lionsgate. So they're changing over to a different studio, so they got to end Preacher because they're going to a different studio now. So that's the real reason as why it's ending. It wasn't that the show was canceled. It wasn't really they're saying, oh, we're just done telling the story. Nope, they switched studios.
So there's still a lot of story to tell.
But it's ending in season 4, and I think it's only 6 episodes.
Huh, so maybe they'll bring it somewhere else.
I don't know, hopefully. It'd be great to do it. I mean, I loved it. I loved the Saint of Killers.
Yeah, I watched the first season, I watched half of the second season, but then I was like in the process of moving and shit, and I fell off, and I just haven't gone back because... everything is just a task to watch that many episodes. I'm like, oh, to catch how many? 15? Like,
the way they do Hell and Satan's Office.
Hell is great, yeah.
Is really awesome. They made it super cheesy to look like, well, of course, that's what the devil would look like. Like your floor or LED screens with fake lava. When you open the door, there's real lava outside.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just so tacky and it's so perfect. So if you haven't watched it on AMC On Demand, you can watch Preacher before season 4 comes about. I think that's it. So we're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk to Epic Lloyd from Epic Rap Battles of History, and then Gittles and I are going to wrap this thing up for this week. We'll be right back.
It's Eric Nagel with Eric and Gittles. More next.
Attention. Shameless social media plug.
It's Eric Nagel is on Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, Facebook. And reluctantly, Snapchat. So follow, like, and subscribe. Would you kindly?
What's up? This is your favorite epic rapper, Epic Lloyd, and you're watching It's Eric Nagel.
Oh,
listening. What's up? This is Epic Lloyd, your favorite epic rapper, and you are listening to It's Eric Nagel.
Epic Rap Battles of History. Eric Nagel. Borsak. Epic Lloyd.
So Epic Lloyd's here. It's been a while, sir. We haven't talked to you in a few years because you haven't done Epic Rap Battles of History in a few years. You've been busy doing your own stuff, and you and Nice Peter took some time off, probably well needed for the amount of grind that you guys put in to do all of these things. But we're here for season 6, and we'll get into that in just a second. But it's great to have Lloyd back on the show here. Lloyd, what have you been up to during the downtime?
I think the last time I saw you, I was doing like a press tour for Epic Studios.
Right.
That was a cool project, and that was really awesome, and I had a lot of fun doing that. So that was a big one. I did a little tour. I went on tour with Jurassic 5 for a couple dates, which was really fun and like a big honor for me. I love those guys.
Do you play anything, or are you just doing like some singing, rapping stuff with them?
Yeah, well, I was opening for them. So I like opened for Jurassic 5 on the road. And yeah, that was like awesome. So I did like 30-minute like hip hop set, like just all original music. It was killer, man. It was like a highlight.
How does their crowd differ from the Epic Rap Battles of History crowd?
Their crowds are a little less nerdy and a little bit more like classic hip hop fans. I think they might be just a touch older than our fans are, you know, right. Like I think they're like a golden age kind of rap band.
Of course.
But like a lot of the same people for sure, you know, like a lot of crossover, just a lot of people who love good music, and their live show is insane. It was so good.
For people who don't know about Lloyd, outside of doing the rap battle stuff on YouTube, he puts out his own music. So you put out an album not too long ago. You do the Diss Raps for Hire, which is taking on its own life, which we'll get into that in a second. But doing hip hop is not something that is new to you. It's not something like, yeah, you know what, I'm going to try it and it worked for here, I'm going to try to make a career out of it. This has been a passion of yours for a long time, even before doing the Epic Rap Battles.
Yeah, way before. Yeah, I started writing rhymes in like 2000, maybe even 1999. I used to do a bunch of one-man shows. Like I used to do this show called Characters of Self and Rhyme Show, where I would do like a one-man open mic, and I would play all these different characters doing different rap verses and different poetry verses and stuff, and did that, and like did a lot of fringe festivals and stuff. And that's how I met Pete, was just at a party, just freestyling on the porch. So we were always like be rapping and rhyming and stuff on the, you know, at parties and stuff. And he was just the other guy at the parties that I was like, that guy can rap pretty good, you know? So yeah, rap has always been something that I did.
I like the fact that you met and at a party, but you were freestyle rapping on a porch. That seems like a great way to end the series, with you two guys old and gray way in the future, and you just sitting there, you know, like the Bartles and James guys on rocking chairs, just doing freestyle battles on the porch. As it just doesn't stop, the camera pulls away, you're in this house, white picket fence in the middle of the country, and then it just ends like that.
Yeah, but we have to be drinking a Bartles and James, because I don't even know if those things exist anymore. We'll have to dig them up.
Well, this is your opportunity to bring them back in a very big way.
Yeah.
So you do your own solo stuff. By the way, what's the name of the CD or album, whatever they call it nowadays, and where can you get it?
Yeah, Here. It's called Here. And you can get it on iTunes, Amazon, Google Play, any place like that. Anywhere you can download music, you can get it. And yeah, I made a bunch of videos on my own channel, which is like youtube.com/ERB. I mean, /Epic Lloyd. That's my channel. So yeah, the EP is really cool. It's a lot of my favorite songs that I've ever made.
You also did, we mentioned this earlier, one of my favorite series called Diss Raps for Hire, where people could actually hire you to write a diss rap about somebody in their life that's given them a lot of grief, causing a lot of pain, or just being an overall asshole. And the storyline is so great, because it's got the Strong Bad Emails vibe, where you're reading your thing and you go, what? That's it. And then all of a sudden this whole adventure breaks out where the video's up and ready to go. Where did the idea for that come along?
It came from the people on my YouTube page. There used to be, back in the day, there was a front page of your YouTube page, and that's where comments would show up. It was like you would have video comments, but you would also have page comments. And this kid wrote on my front page out of nowhere, like, hey man, my name is Sharpie Twin Tip, and my older brother picks on me. He's always, you know, beating me up, and like, he's ugly, and he has only one eyebrow, and he has like a mustache. And if you could write a rap destroying him, that would really be awesome. And I was like, that sounds pretty cool. And so it started kind of light, you know. It was sort of a little bit more lighthearted at first. And then the stories that started coming in got sort of more and more serious. So that's why I started giving it more and more attention, because it was like, not because I felt that like I needed to save these people with a rap, but because them feeling like they were being heard really helped them. So it was really inspiring. It was cool. And it sort of took off.
Will that be continuing anytime soon, or is it everything focused on ERB right now?
Everything right now is ERB season 6. I can see the future where Disraps comes back for sure. But it's taken every ounce of focus for us to get this new season together, put all the infrastructure together on our own, get everything in place. But we're independent now, so we have to put these structures in place, and to do it right, it takes out all the focus that I have. So that's what we're doing.
So let's talk about season 6 then. My first question actually is what you just said. Last we saw you guys, your studio that was producing Epic Rap Battles, Maker Studios, was acquired by Disney. Now you guys are independent. How do you get out of that deal? Like, if your studio is absorbed by Disney, how do you walk away with it and still have Epic Rap Battles of History as your own to go and do what you want?
I can't really talk too much about the details of it. But I will say this: it wasn't painful. It wasn't awful or anything. It was good. And we were able to say, hey, we're independent now, and we're going to do our own thing. And that's pretty much all I can say. But I will say that it was nice, and it felt like it was a big question mark for a while.
Right.
Like if we would be able to do something like that. So that was part of the break, and that was part of why we took so long off. Not all of it, but part of it. Now we're just excited for the future, and we're excited to put all this stuff together, and it's a ton of hard work. So that's why it takes so much focus. Like when you're on your own, all of a sudden you realize you're like, whoa, there was a lot of stuff going on that we weren't really handling, or we thought we were, and we weren't. And now we have to do all this stuff by ourselves, and it's great work, but it's a lot of work.
So did you lose a lot of your staff? Because one of the cool things you guys do is that on the ERB2 channel on YouTube, you show behind the scenes of how certain videos come to light. And when you see the background of it, you think it's like, well, these guys are just, writing raps and dressing up and standing in front of a green screen, but they got makeup people. They've got costume people. They've got researchers. Like your buddy Zach is amazing wordsmith with tying in words and phrases together to make rap songs that you wouldn't think would even be possible. You've got prop design. You got all of this stuff here. Now, do they come with you as you were leaving, or did you have to part ways? And this is where the reality is that you have to do all of this yourself.
No, by doing it ourselves, it doesn't mean we're doing it. We have Atul is still with us. Zach is still with us. Most of our production team is still with us. And a lot of those people, they work different places as well. But like we're able to work with them a lot. We have a bunch of new people as well, editors. But we're lucky enough to work with a lot of the same people. And yeah, just to be clear, when I say doing it ourselves, we're not doing it ourselves. We're just putting the processes in place on our own. You know what I mean? Like,
oh no, yeah,
you got to be
the business guys now.
Yeah.
Well, I was just curious because when Conan left NBC in New York City and moved to Los Angeles, he was able to bring. Sorry, he didn't leave NBC. He left New York City to go to Los Angeles. He brought all his staff, the majority of his staff, with him to NBC out there when he was doing the Tonight Show. He was only there for a short time at the Tonight Show. When he left there, he went for a while. He didn't have a job. He was touring around the country. But when he signed a new deal with TBS and Turner, he was able to bring his staff with him from the other deal to this deal. And that was pretty unheard of at the time to have the ability to do that. So I was just wondering, in the same aspect, didn't you still work with all the same people before when you were still with Disney as to doing it independently now?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of those folks were either contractors or like the way LA works a lot of times is you work at 20 different places at the same time, you know. So a lot of our folks are available to work with us again. And it's not like we left town like Conan did, you know. So we got a lot of the same people on board.
You just never know if they're contracted to the studio that they can't work because they have an agreement with the studio.
Yeah, we haven't run into that at all.
That's awesome that you get to have essentially the band back together for you to do all this stuff. Now, you guys being the business heads, how is this driving you crazy? Because creative people are not necessarily the best business people. They're not necessarily they're not numbers people, you know? So when you have to sit down there and look at spreadsheets and look at cost and salary and all and location fees and whatever you got to pay for, how is this, like, have you essentially grown up in a way? So now that you have to learn the business because you're running it all yourself, or do you have to bring people in to help you with that?
Well, both, you know, I think, like, unlike a lot of YouTube people, like Pete and I both had a pretty long history of working in the comedy world before Rap Battles hit. So I own a bunch of businesses. I own a comedy club called Westside Comedy in Santa Monica and a touring company called Mission Improvable, which is where me and Pete met. So I've been sort of a business person for a long time. And I think maybe that's part of a big part of what I bring to this in terms of, you know, we probably have, we have like five touring companies going at any given time on Mission Improvable. And at the theater, there's seven show, there's shows seven nights a week. And I don't run that, but my business partners and I do together. So I've had a good sense of that. And Pete, the same way, he toured by himself for a long time and did his own shows at bars and clubs and things. So, and selling merch and things. So you have to be pretty savvy that way. So that comes into play, but then we do have a lot of help. You know, there are people here. We have a manager, Ed, who's in the UK, and he's just amazing at just crossing T's and dotting I's. And we have some, you know, financial people out here that help us and help us, you know, keep things in the black as much as we can. So we're really early yet still, you know, we just started uploading in January. In December, we uploaded that like a bonus battle. And then we upload the first episode of season 6 on Saturday. So we're doing pretty good, but we're still really early in it. So if you talk to me in another 6 months, I might be just like ripping my skin off. Right now, it's been pretty good.
You know, this makes a little bit more sense now for the end of season 5, which was, Jesus, a couple of years ago now. The last episode you guys did in the season 5 was Nice Peter versus Epic Lloyd round 2. And you two were going back and forth. And I'm looking at this and I said, I wonder how much realism is in this, because this seems to be stemming from a lot of legit places as far as their arguments. And they said, you know what, they're creative enough and they're good enough at what they do that they could take reality, put it into the work and not cause problems with each other. It's like, well, I'm going to say this about you, then you could say this about me because we do all this stuff. And you guys went for it. And I think, surprisingly, for people who are used to you guys doing characters, seeing you two together hash it out and then it ends the way as brothers would after this knockdown, drag out thing. I can't stand you. All right, you want to go get something to eat? Yeah, let's go. You know, and it just ends that way. And I think that really became your shining piece for season 5, and not knocking the others, but at one, the way at the end there, because at that point, nobody knew. We didn't know that you guys were going to be off that long. And then eventually over time, I was like, is this the end? Is this how it's going to go out? And if it was, that was the perfect way to do it.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, it's still, there was a lot of question marks there. We really didn't know what was going to happen at that point. And geez, a lot has happened since, you know, you know, I did all those projects and stuff, and Pete's, you know, personal, you know, he has a daughter now, and that's like a big, I mean, how much bigger can you get in terms of like a life change? So yeah, we felt, usually we have a lot of people help us write the battles and the jokes, but on that battle, we pretty much did that one on our own, cause it was so personal and because it was so like, yeah, exactly. Like heartfelt, like this is coming from a place of real, you know, realism. We were burnt out. We were a little bit pissed off at each other at times, not pissed, but like, you know, you go through it and it's stressful. So I'm glad you say that. A lot of people overlook that battle for, you know, because it's not as colorful or bombastic character wise. But I really like that one too.
I liked it because it was more real than the others. You know, obviously the others, but to see that, I was like, that is a great way to end the season. But and then, like we said, as time went on, like if that's how they're going out, that's the perfect way to go out for them. At least for right now, it is.
Yeah. Well, Now we're back.
Now we're back. I'm going to get into season six in a second, but some more compliments for you for season five.
Oh, all right.
I love your Theodore Roosevelt. Now, for those who don't know the history of Theodore Roosevelt tied into the epic rap battle world, Theodore was the it was a bit Monty Python-esque. It's where they took the photo and they had the mouth moving like a Terry Gilliam piece, and Lloyd was doing Teddy Roosevelt as this, you know, this badass who was just giving you news updates about what's coming for the first half of the season, the second half of the season, or merchandise or anything silly they wanted to throw in there. And then he got upgraded in season five to being his own rap battle character, where he squares off against Winston Churchill. And it's one of my favorites of all time. And you wouldn't think it would be because of how old, because everything now with the millennial generation, if it's before they were born, they don't care. But yeah, those characters are so old that they really stood out more than a lot of the other characters do. And like, these are two old school badasses who had one was a fitness buff who had family problems. The other one was dealing with wartime, who had family problems and also a bit of an alcoholic. And they're still just doing a knockdown bare knuckle fight against each other here. And like, this still works in this time. Bringing these, and it's true to what you guys do with the title historical rap battles. I just wanted to point that out, that the Theodore Roosevelt character has really grown to be a favorite of mine.
Oh, thanks, man. Obviously, got a shout out to Dan Bull, who played Winston Churchill. It's like I've done another battle with him, which was Hannibal Lecter and Jack the Ripper, and that's another favorite of mine. He's just a great rapper and great writer. And yeah, I was nervous about that battle because Teddy Roosevelt is sort of a really important character for me as, you know, the voice of him in the news, which I really love doing. So when we were bringing that to life, it was like, we really got to get this right. We have to get this right. It's kind of important that we do it. And also, like, I never wanted to be one of those groups that, like, they're like, just play your old stuff. You know what I mean? Like, I wanted to make sure that our new stuff is still good and raw and fresh and and Pete, just on the editing side of that, was just exceptional with the whole crew of that. So it was nice. It was really nice, and it's got some pretty good jabs in there. I love World War Too Soon is pretty funny.
The James Bond versus Austin Powers one, when it came out, you were like, oh, that's amazing, but also you're thinking, oh, that's a no-brainer because Austin was a parody of James Bond. But that one seemed to translate to a lot of older audiences, because I showed it to an uncle and he looked at it because he was a diehard, or still is a diehard, James Bond fan. And that franchise has been around for 50 something years, and there's been so many different actors portraying James Bond that it's almost like Doctor Who. Everybody has their favorite doctor. Everybody has their favorite Bond. And showing the new Bond, which a lot of the old school fans love, and then Sean Connery coming in at the end with his... And this was amazing for you to add into, with his old school demeanor. But when people look back now in the Me Too age and what have you, they look back at the Sean Connery era and they go, a lot of that stuff's very inappropriate. You could never get away with it. And you brought a touch of that back into the character to show that he doesn't give a shit. He is who he is and he'll always be who he is. And that's pretty much what Sean Connery is to this day. He's not apologetic for anything. And to bring that in there in a time when everything that's like a little bit sensitive to people was a real testament to the amount of work that you guys put into this and the chances that you guys are willing to take. Bringing that back in there really just capped the whole thing perfectly.
Yeah, man. You can't. I mean, it's the same. I say the same thing all the way back to the beginning of the series when we did Vader versus Hitler. And like, one of the jokes that put us sort of on the board was the, you know, you stink, Vader, your style smells something sour. You need to wash up here, step in my shower. It's like, do we make this Holocaust joke? And for me, it was like, we have to. It's much more insulting to the people who are hurt by that event to ignore it and pretend it didn't happen.
Right.
So it kind of applies to every character, you know, when Sean Connery was, he would slap a woman in almost every, you know, episode, movie, whatever, like a misogynist to the bone. And as long as you call that out and like make it a joke, like, or like a, you know, a diss to him, then you can sort of portray it, but you have to definitely have to like call it out.
Yeah, he comes in proudly representing it and flaunting it, and the other characters are saying, dude, do you know what you're not self-aware. You can't be doing these kind of things, and he doesn't give a shit. So at least it's being mentioned. It's not being dealt with, but it's being addressed all across the board, so that kind of makes it okay. In light of...
I'm crazy over here. Hey!
What kind of dog you have?
A tiny, barky one.
Yeah, I do too. I got a French bulldog.
Oh, yeah. Nice. She's fine.
In light of the new, the final season of Game of Thrones that just came out, did you see any increase in traffic or mentions for your episode of J.R.R. Tolkien versus J.R.R. Martin? Because I put it up there. Everyone else is either saying, I have never seen Game of Thrones, and they're proud of it, or everybody else is going nuts saying, Game of Thrones starts in 5 hours, 4 hours, whatever. About an hour before, I said, Game of Thrones starting now, and I posted the thing, and people who I from our audience have never seen it were writing back like, this is amazing. So did you see a resurgence of that video leading into Game of Thrones?
You know, I didn't. I haven't checked quite yet. I wouldn't be surprised if there is, and like that's kind of the nice thing about doing iconic characters is every time a new season of that comes out, there's a little bump, or you know, every time there's a new Bond movie, or if there's like a you know another Deadpool film comes out, it's kind of nice that we can redistribute it. Right now, we're just focused on making the new battle. So I haven't really like dug into the analytics too much, but thanks for sharing that. That's awesome.
Well, I asked that because on, when you guys announced that you were coming back, you started doing a lot of creative stuff on the ERB2 channel where you were doing collections, which was awesome of the different, like your buddy, forgive me. I forgot his name, who was, Churchill.
Dan Bull.
Dan Bull. You'll have collections of like Dan Bull's appearances in Epic Rap Battles. Yeah. You'll have collections of Zach Sherwin. You'll have all these different things where you can say, if you like this particular person, here's all the characters they portrayed throughout the history of this series. And then you were doing special behind the scenes things. Then you were also doing these light versions of Epic Rap Battles of History where it's just you and Pete on the mics back and forth with each other. No costumes, no effects, no whatever. You're just saying, I'm Burger King, he's McDonald's, go. And then you guys, by the way,
flash in the pan hip hop conflicts of nowadays.
Yeah.
The official spinoff.
Yeah. And they were all right at the end. It was like, who won? Who cares? This doesn't mean anything. And it was just, it was nice to see that, well, we have these ideas. We don't know if we can do a full scale production of this. Let's do it in this form and give it a go. And I think they were brilliant. And it's a great way to keep the people, one, signing up to your Patreon, by the way, Patreon/ERB. ERB. And another is to just keep people excited and waiting for the upcoming season 6.
Yeah. The second channel is a great, you know, the Rap Battles channel, the main channel is sort of for the canon, you know, if we're legitimate enough to say that, like just the episodes go up there pretty much, and maybe the news. But the second channel is, there's a lot of, you know, more potential there. We could upload there a lot, and we tried to do it weekly in this interim period, and we're going to try to keep doing it. You know, sometimes YouTube favors compilation videos or longer videos, so it's nice to give, you know, feed Papa an algorithm that a little bit. But we've also found that people just really enjoy it. You know, they really like being like, oh yeah, I've never watched the 3 Rhett and Link episodes back to back to back, or you know, the Key and Peele episodes back to back. That's really fun. And now that with the new seasons in play, we can just supplement the monthly uploads with stuff on the second channel. And then, yeah, also the Patreon is going to be a great place if people want to, you know, get a little bit more behind the scenes stuff, get a little more extras, get things like that. The Patreon is going to be a really cool place for people to see it.
Explain what's on the Patreon there. Well, like, what are some of the tiers? What are the incentives for people? Obviously, you guys do great work, so why wouldn't you want to donate to it? But what are the tiers that a Patreon offers to for people who are not quite into or aware of what you guys do? What do they get for their money?
Good, right on. So there's 3 tiers. There's $5, there's $10, and there's $25. And for the $5 tier, you get access to the Discord that we were talking about earlier today. And then a bunch of like extra bonus content. So like we released the thumbnail to the battle early there, and you'll get bonus behind the scenes footage and like green screen cuts of videos and things, just a whole bunch of extra bonus footage. Then in the $10 level, you get access to like a special writer's Discord where you can help us submit lyrics. Like we'll ask for like special lyric, like, hey man, we need a lyric for this battle that's coming up. Help us write this battle. So you get to contribute. Wow. And maybe have your stuff be part of the battle. It's for people who don't mind spoilers. There's definitely more spoilers in there. We're not going to spoil every battle, but, and you know, we're pretty good about being like, hey, this is a spoiler. If you don't want to see it, don't look at this. But so that's a $10 level, which is pretty cool. And then the $25 level, you get your name in the credits of the battle at the end. And then there's some special giveaways and stuff that we'll do. Like every 3 months, you get a special piece of merchandise that we'll make just for that level. And there's a couple other things that I'm not exactly explaining, but they're pretty. You can find it all on Patreon.com/ERB.
That's interesting that you're doing that. That's almost like exclusive concert shirts or wrestling. For WWE, sometimes they'll have a specific shirt based on the town that they're performing in. If you have specific shirts for the battles that you're doing at the time, a limited run, say it's for 3 days, you can buy this at whatever price and then they're gone forever. People love those things. Whether they wear them or not, people just love to collect limited edition things. So by doing that, I think that's a great way to bring in more revenue to do what you do. Plus, you guys put out some good stuff. By the way, I'm the guy who wore the shirt to the concert. I'm wearing my old ERB shirt, which is pretty much seen better days. It's unraveling at the bottom.
We'll have to send you something, man. We'll send you one.
Yeah, but I got to sign up for the Patreon. I'm going to hit the $25 level. I'm going to brag about it and support these guys because I've loved these guys for years and they've always been cool to come on my show and talk about these things. I got to ask you about Rhett and Link. So I discovered Rhett and Link and Smosh through you guys, right? Okay. And Smosh is just its own universe. And Rhett and Link have really grown into their own with Good Mythical Morning and their world to the level that they've been on The Tonight Show a handful of times.
Yeah.
When are we getting you guys on The Tonight Show? This is something that Jimmy Fallon should be all over.
Yeah, that's a good question. We were on the James Corden show and we did a battle on there, which was really cool.
Right.
Usually the reason why we don't go on late night shows is because we would have to perform or do one of the battles or do something ahead of time, which we'd really want to prepare a lot for. And it's really difficult for us to be in production and then also prepare for like a late night show. So, that was the only thing that's ever stood really in the way. But if Jimmy Fallon wants us on a show, we'll be there.
Well, I'm sure everybody's got to write to Jimmy Fallon and get the ERB guys on there. But I think the way to do it is you might have to do a little trickery, a little old school thinking here. So if you did, and I pitched this to you a while ago, but I'm going to do it again. So if you did an ERB where it's just the history of late night, you know, where it starts off with Conan or Fallon or Colbert or whatever. And then one of the great things you do is when you start off some, and these are usually the big epic half season or end of season ones where more and more characters come in there to kind of school everybody on it, where Letterman shows up, where Leno shows up, Carson shows up, Jack Parr shows up, like the history of these shows where the one's coming into the other and yelling at and then nothing gets resolved are usually some of the funniest works that you guys do. So if you do that and you just tip them off, say, hey, look, we have this thing. We'd like to debut it on The Tonight Show. It involves Fallon, or maybe Fallon could be, because you've had celebrities come and do things. This might be something he'd want to do. You do that. You show up there. You don't even have to perform. You do panel. You talk a little bit and debuts on The Tonight Show at the same time it goes up on your channel and the website.
I mean, yeah, that's
it's a little ass kissing, but the way the world works now.
That'd be the way to do it. That's 100% the way to do it. I mean, we've thought about that for sure, and it's not out of the question at all. Like, I've always wanted to do Conan versus Conan, just Conan the Barbarian. Yeah. Conan O'Brien.
Yep.
It's been a big favorite of mine forever. So yeah, I mean, that would be great. That's, we have some stuff up our sleeve for this season for sure. So I think that that's where we're going. You know what I mean? Like all of those decisions and all those phone calls and all of those like plans are in our, that's in our court to like set that stuff up now. And like, we're still a little baby production company and our knees are forming. But as we get more and more into the season, I think we'll have the bandwidth to be like, you know what, let's lock this department down, this whatever PR or, you know, outreach or press department down. And that'll be a part of the gig and all those plans will come together. We just didn't even know how everything was going to roll out at first. And now the plans are starting to come in place. So
the storylines and characters that you guys are always cool, where you ask a lot of people, you ask your fan base pretty much, hey, post the comments at the bottom of this video and who would you like to see upcoming future battles? Has there been anybody that you wanted, like celebrity wise, to appear in a battle and they just were not interested in doing it or just couldn't do it, and that kind of prevented you from doing the story?
Not really. No, actually, I mean, I feel kind of lucky to say that. We've never really, we don't approach too many people. You know, we're pretty I thought Weird Al Yankovic was like just such a long shot, and he was super down to do it. And
you know, Weird Al's a great example of, he's got those stories where he wanted to do songs and he doesn't have to ask the artist because he doesn't need to, but he does anyway as a professional courtesy. And he tells stories about people who have turned his songs down and then he didn't wind up doing, except for one where he wasn't aware the artist wasn't cool with it, which was Coolio when he put out Amish Paradise.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he thought his people cleared everything, and then during an interview after Coolio won a Grammy, they were asking him about it, and he was kind of shitting on Weird Al, and Weird Al had no idea that he wasn't cool with it, so he wouldn't have done it. But he's talked about Paul McCartney and Prince and a couple other people who said that no, they didn't like what he was doing with their song, they'd rather he didn't, so he didn't do it. You know, but then he was surprised that he asked Michael Jackson and Kurt Cobain and they were all about it. They wanted him to do that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. We haven't, if we're going to parody someone like, trying to think like Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton or something like that, we don't really ever reach out to ask them if it's okay with them.
Well, that's political and public figures. So you can do that.
So yeah, no, everybody that we've ever really approached, if they were able to do it, you know, logistically, they've been really, really open to do it, you know, which is really cool.
What about the reverse? Have there been celebrities or musicians, some that have reached out to you and say, hey, if you guys ever do something, I'd like to be a part of it?
Sort of. Like, I guess the closest would be maybe Snoop Dogg. Like, he didn't like reach out and say, hey, I want to work with you. But like when in the early days of Maker, he was interested in digital media and what was going on there. And they would walk him through the facility and tour him through all the time. And we were always one of the stops that they would make on the tour because we were one of the bigger shows. And so when he came in, like just that opportunity was like, he was open to doing stuff with people at the company. So we were like, you think he would be in a battle, you know, and he was down to do it. So I guess that's the closest thing. Some people have tweeted at us and stuff about like, hey, I'd like to be in a battle. And it usually just comes down to casting. Like, who does this person look like? What character would they play? Does it make sense? And if we can make it happen, we do.
You had J.B. Smoove in there doing Frederick Douglass, which was awesome. Yeah. But then you got Arnold Schwarzenegger in there being Arnold Schwarzenegger. So you didn't really have to stretch with that.
Yeah, that was like that was a promotional thing for the Terminator movie. And so he did a bunch of they reached out to us to like, there's a little bit of a promotion for that movie at the end of the video there. So they worked that out, which was cool. And then, yeah, he was at the we worked it out. Like he was at the YouTube space and he did a bunch of different cameos and a bunch of different videos. And that was our chance to meet him. He was cool.
You have some good promotional tie-ins. You did that one with the pirate ship where it was Al Capone versus
Assassin's Creed, and
so while the video's going on, the battle's going on, you're seeing parts of the game in the video, like just in the background, like it's no big deal. You're just seeing the assassins going through. You're seeing cannons and being launched and ships being destroyed, all while Al Capone's being made fun of for having syphilis.
Yeah, we always wanted to make it kind of seamless, you know, if that makes sense. Like, it's never like cornflakes and ERB. It's we try to like work it into the video in a cool way, and we've definitely turned some deals like that down to try to just keep it kind of clean, right. You know. That one was really fun.
Who hasn't liked what you've done?
Who hasn't liked what we have done? Like what battles people haven't liked?
No, like, all right, if somebody, a current figure that you happen to parody in the video, has anybody reached out and said their people said they weren't happy with it or they didn't like it? Like the Caitlyn Jenner versus the Bruce Jenner versus Bruce Banner one, where you have Bruce turn into, spoilers, Bruce turns into Caitlyn as her way of hulking up. And yeah. So you would think that, though that might cause a problem, or you may hear from their people that she's not happy or whatever, but I don't think that has happened. Has it happened at all where you've parodied somebody and they said, this is no good?
No, man. I wish, I mean, I guess I'm kind of proud of that in terms of like, we do our best to make both sides look good. Like, sometimes the only battles that I ever am disappointed in myself in or us is if it feels like a one-sided victory because of the writing, because of the video, the production or whatever. But every battle, even like, you know, even Donald Trump versus Hillary Clinton, I was like for a while, you know, I'm not a personal supporter of him, but I'm like, I have to write this as if I am, and I have to like represent this as if I am.
Right.
And so, yeah, we've been lucky enough not to, almost like Weird Al, you know, for the most part, when Weird Al does a parody of you, it's sort of like an honor, you know what I mean? And so that's what we try to do, is really honor the people that are alive that we put in the battles, you know?
All right. Season 6, it's here. It's out. Just so you know, this is going out 6 a.m. Friday morning. So the day that you guys debut. Season 6 is here.
It's going out Friday. We debut on Saturday, so 4/20.
Okay, there you go. So I thought it was today. So it's tomorrow. So yeah. Season 6 is here tomorrow, 4/20. Great day to put it out, by the way. I didn't even think about that until now. But we don't know much about Season 6. You guys have been kind of tight-lipped on that. Is there anything that you can, without giving away too much, is there anything you could tell us? Is there at least certain genres, maybe a certain TV show or movie or something that you parody? Is there something vague enough that you can give us an idea of what we're looking for?
I can say that there will be adamantium involved.
Don't drink, don't smoke. What do you do? Adamantium?
Yeah.
Okay, so that kind of gives away, and that's good too. In light of a certain merger that just took place, it will tie in nicely to that. Hopefully, that's addressed in there. Or I don't know if you're skirting away from your old business partner. We'll have to wait and see. Is there any? Is there going to be merch right off the bat for the start of Season 6? And like on Saturday, people go to the website, they see the announcement that there's a new video, they go to check out the video. Is there new merch right out off the bat there for them to buy?
There is. We actually like have this partnership with, it's called Teespring, and it's, you can get the merch through the YouTube page. So there's certainly like the t-shirt you have there still available, but there's all sorts of new items. Like we have like a baby onesie with the logo on it, which I think is really fun. And just like all sorts of different little things that you can get custom made. So there's a bunch of that. And then we're going to start rolling out new merch probably as the season goes on. But those items are available now.
By doing this independently, do you find that it's going to take longer to put these things out? Because you guys just revealed the rollout for the Season 6. And so you have an episode on 4/20. Then you have one more being released about 2 weeks later. But then it's once a month until the season is done.
Yeah.
Which is different from your previous schedule, where you guys would go every 2 weeks until it was done. And then you had a couple of months off doing what you were doing until the next season.
Yeah, you know, we've changed it almost every season we've ever done it. You know, for a while, you're right, it was every 2 weeks. Then we have done it once a month in the past, and we did it even weekly at one point, which was crazy. So, yeah, once a month I think is going to be what works for us this season in terms of workload. And it's easy to remember. It's easy to tell somebody, hey, it's the first of every month, or it's not the first of every month. It's every month. So yeah, we're looking forward to that, and we're going to try to continue to put out secondary content on the second channel, ERB2, and on the Patreon as well. So there should be a lot of good stuff coming out. And we have a Facebook page and an Instagram page that people can check out for, you know, on-set photos, and there's some giveaways and stuff like that on those pages as well.
Yeah, for the Twitter and the Instagram, it's ERB of History, so you can follow those. You type in Epic Rap Battles of History in Facebook, the page pops up right there. And, of course, the website is EpicRapBattlesOfHistory.com. The YouTube /ERB or ERB2 for all of that stuff. Get that out there. And the Patreon /ERB to help support these guys since they're doing everything independently here. Before we go, Lloyd, let me ask you, you've done a lot of interviews. You guys have been doing this for a long time. What hasn't been asked? Like, what hasn't anyone asked you that you guys were expecting? Like, oh, they're probably going to ask about this, or you're dreading they're going to ask about this, and then it's never come up. Or what's something that you wanted to talk about that's never come up? What has not been asked to you?
Well, that's not been asked. No one's ever asked me that.
So we win.
You do win that. That's a great question. I guess, I would like for people to know, like, you know, why we make these, you know, like, people ask us how we make them and what started us making them, and you know, every other question about the history of it and stuff. But no one ever really asks, like, why, you know. And I think that's a good question. And I think the answer is, you know, it's like a really great combination of all the things that I've ever wanted to do. I get to make rap songs that I think are funny. I get to be I have a big improv background, so I get to be these big boisterous characters that sort of fits for me. I get to work with my best friends, and I get to do it in a way that I call the shots creatively. So, and then I also, even though I always was like a live performer, I find myself constantly watching reaction videos of the battles on the internet, because it's so nice to see people laugh at the stuff that I've made, and that when you upload it and you see it live on the page, but you don't really hear anything because you're watching a video, right? So then I watch these reactions, and just the fact that you're bringing sort of like some good vibes into people's house or their hospital bed or their army barracks or like they're overseas or, you know, wherever they're at, that really feels good. And that was a big part of the reason we're like, no, we're going to do, we got more gas in the tank for this. We have some more of this. And that was a lot of my motivation. So
what about Epic Rap Battles of History, the movie trailer?
Yeah.
Like a movie that will never exist, but let's see what, this is the kind of trailer we would like to do. And this is the absurdity that you would see in it. Cause you don't need to do that right away. That can take time to do it, because you could get different people to pop in there, and it could just be one of those, like the Deadpool trailer that was leaked. They shot it, they filmed it themselves, that action sequence, and released it around Comic-Con time. They claim nobody knows who did it, wink, but that was what finally greenlit Deadpool with Fox, saying, okay, we have to do this because there's too big a demand. So even not looking to make the actual movie, what about, it fits in your wheelhouse, doing Epic Rap Battles, the movie.
Yeah, I think it would probably be sort of like a little bit of like a Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure kind of vibe or something like that. Or maybe, you know, some elements of Hamilton or something. I feel like if we ever did a movie, I would want it to stand on its own and be its own thing. Sort of like the South Park guys did, where it was like the show and used a lot of characters, but it was its own thing. And then their Broadway play was its own thing. I think it would have to hook around some event or something, maybe like, you know, a World War II or like a Civil War or something like that, where we could really pit the characters against each other. And yeah, who knows what the hell would happen, you know? That's even a bigger dream of mine. Like, shit, let's make a movie. Hell yeah, let's do it.
That could be a $500 tier. You know, and it's limited to a certain amount of people. Once it's done, it's done. You get your name in the credits at the end there to make Epic Rap Battles the movie trailer.
You know, people are so dang generous, man. I'm astounded and so surprised that, like, I am happy that I was able to make something in my entertainment career that people feel inspired to want to be a part of. And that sounds sort of like boilerplate comment, like thanks, but I really feel that, you know, like people, you forget sometimes living in a giant city like New York or LA, that not everybody has the ability to do all these cultural things and just reach out and go to see comedy in one of the best clubs in the world. Not everybody has the ability to do that. And things like Patreon and reaching out and feeling like you're a part of something is really satisfying for people. And I'm happy that I can be on the receiving end of that. And I hope that what we do is like earns it. You know, that's what we always want to do is just earn it.
Epic Lloyd, thank you so much for coming on, man. You've always been very cool and generous with your time, and I really do appreciate you coming back here again. We hit all the vitals as far as everything we have to plug here. Is there anything else you want to throw out there for people to know about, to go check out?
That's the big one. Season 6 debuts 420 on the ERB channel. We got a new Patreon page. If you can't follow that, no worries at all. Just follow us online and keep watching. Thanks so much for having us.
So you have season 6 on the ERB channel, and you know, 420 is somebody's birthday who you did a three-parter about. Maybe that shows up on as a collection for ERB 2.
There you go.
There you go. Lloyd, thank you so much, man. Oh, what's your Twitter so they can follow you?
Yeah, I'm at the Epic Lloyd on Twitter and on Instagram. So follow me there.
All right. Thanks so much, man. I really appreciate it.
Man, my pleasure. Thanks for having us.
Thanks so much to Epic Lloyd for coming and talking to us about season 6 for Epic Rap Battles of History. We just did all the plugs. Check it out on April 20th. But now, with that music, it means it's time for us to wrap up and get out of here for this week. Gittles, what do you have?
I got GittleBass on the Twitter, Instagram, and Xbox Live. And that's it right now. I don't have any takedowns coming up because I've been busy doing shit. But yeah, that's what I got to plug.
All right. For me, it's E-Rock Radio across the board on social media. But for the show, which is more important, it's Eric Nagel across the board on all the social media platforms. Like us on Facebook. Subscribe to us on YouTube. If you want to leave a voicemail to be used on future episodes of the show, call 651-SMITHERS. That's 651-764-8437. I think that's it. It was a lot of show this week.
We crammed a lot in.
We did, because we were sort of not doing a real show last week with our buddy Justin Moriello, which was a great episode. If you haven't heard that, go back and download that one. It was a good
He's
time.
Sherlock's nemesis.
He is.
Moriello.
He's exactly who he is. But we crammed a lot into this week's episode. Next week, 10 minutes. In and out. Done.
Boom. Done. Like a bank robbery.
Until the next time, everybody, be excellent to each other and...
And be excellent. Oh, shit. And have a wonderful time.
You're rusty. It's been a while.
And have a wonderful time.
There you go. And we'll
Is
be
Is that rustier? Rusty Venture?
Nice talk, Russ. We'll be seeing you.
It's Eric Nagel.
Take Carl. Go to Mum's. Kill Phil.
Sorry.
Grab Liz. Go to the Winchester. Have a nice cold pint and wait for all this to blow over.
Alas, we're out of time.
Follow It's Eric Nagel on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. For ways to listen to the show, go to itsericnagel.com. And remember to tell two friends so they can tell two friends. And they can tell two friends.
And they can tell two friends.
And those two friends can tell two friends.
And those two friends can tell two friends.